Welcome, good afternoon. I'm Ram Golamudi from Zagg Networks. I'm the CEO of the company. Little bit about myself, I've got around 15 years experience. I've been a serial entrepreneur, engineer, and a venture capitalist myself. I started my career in California. I worked for a bunch of venture-backed companies in networking and communication. I've seen most outcomes of a startup. One went IPO, one went public, and one went belly up. So I kind of realized that this is a fantastic thing. And then made some money and then joined a venture capital firm in California, investing in early stage companies. We managed around 500 million assets. And then I wanted to get back to entrepreneurship. So last several years, I was a founder and CEO of an education mobile SaaS company serving the Indian market, right? So I have a lot of operating experience both in the US and in India. And I recently joined Zagg Protocol as a CEO. And that's because I really was fascinated and really excited by the opportunity which was presented to me. The original founder of the company, Raj, he's actually wanted to be here. But hey, Raj, I think he's on the TV and the Zagg team. So they wanted to be here, but they couldn't. So he's been a visionary. He's been in the gift card, loyalty, reward space for the last 15, 20 years. He understands the business, and more importantly, understands the pain points as to why the industry needs to be disrupted with a blockchain kind of technology, right? So when he painted the vision as to what we can do together in building a large project, I got excited and joined them, right? Okay, so if you look at the whole gift card, benefits, rewards, and loyalty space, this is all money which all of us have in our pockets, but we rarely use or very hard to use, right? Example, it's like probably around $160 billion of loyalty reward points get unredeemed every year. That's all of our money which we paid through our loyalty to brands, right? There are around $45 billion of unused gift cards not being used, right? So there's a lot of this hard money which is currently in the consumer's wallets, not being used because of a variety of reasons, largely because it's illiquid, very hard to really redeem or spend. And it's the same, obviously it's a big problem for the consumers, but it's as much of a problem for the merchants, right? For them, they use these programs largely for customer retention, customer engagement, and when a user doesn't use it, obviously there is a breakage revenue they do get. But for them, this is a lost business opportunity because a customer coming in, using his gift cards, using his loyalty points, can actually be a full force multiplier. He comes in with a dollar or $10 of loyalty card, but then if he uses it, and he typically tends to spend two or three times more than that, right? So there's a lot of lost business opportunity when people don't use these assets. And largely because, why? Why is it happening? Because currently, all the businesses which actually use and run these programs are on antiquated legacy systems. It's extremely hard for them to really provide a user an ability to trade, discover, and offer a better value. And this is where a legacy system like SaaS kind of platforms, I've come from SaaS background, SaaS would not work because it's centralized. There's no value transfer happening, and blockchain is the ideal platform. Because you've got these financial assets, you move them to a blockchain, make them liquid, make them transparent, make them tradable, right? So the first go of this problem was, hey, why don't we build apps on existing platforms, right? Existing blockchains. So a lot of people who've tried, but it's like, hey, 1990s, there was Windows operating system. People said, okay, I'll write a nice fancy application and use it for embedded systems, or use it to put it in a router, or use it for a bunch of applications, which was not the intended target for the operating system, right? So it is that the existing set of protocols are meant for general purpose value transfer. They don't have what it takes to serve this market, because this market needs a couple of things. One, it needs enterprises also, because they are the ones who are administering these programs, and it needs extremely low cost and high scalability, right? So existing protocols don't support it, and hence any apps which are built on these protocols are in the shaky ground and couldn't really take off. That's where we realized that we actually need to innovate at the blockchain level, at the infrastructure level, and have come up with a fundamental protocol which is going to be the protocol for this entire industry, which is GBRL, gift card benefits, rewards and loyalty. If you look at it, what does this industry need? This industry needs broadly these six different key features, right? Enterprise security. Lot of programs are actually administered by enterprises. They also work in coalitions. It is very, very critical that many of these transactions need to be private. So today, public blockchain doesn't allow for it. Second, private public consensus. The second key important point is, even though the consensus might happen on a private network, very essential, again, that it gets recorded on the public blockchain so that a global ledger is maintained and is consistent. Third one, identity management, right? As one user, you are subscribed to, I don't know, 5-10 different loyalty programs. You need a universal identity management system which works across many of these loyalty programs or rewards, and there is none available today, which is what we need to support. Low cost, right? Many a times, these transactions are going to be, maybe $10, $15, and using a Bitcoin kind of system is not going to work, right? You need an extremely low cost system where you can make these transactions workable in the day-to-day life for most consumers. High transaction speed is very critical. You don't want to be standing at a POS waiting for 2 minutes to trade that gift card, right? You want to be able to do it in a couple of seconds. And last but not the least is an exchange. This is something which is very critical about providing liquidity, providing discovery of value for all the money which is in your pockets and you can't spend. Right? As I said, this is the same set of six, seven features we have. One thing I missed is also ability to provide a wallet where there's one single interface for you to discover, access all the set of financial assets which you have as part of this GBRL community, right? Zagg infrastructure, this infrastructure is very critical. I just want to take maybe 5-10 seconds to explain it. Any transactions could come from either consumers or coalitions. Typically, many of these GBRL market, you have coalitions of star alliances, like one such coalition, right? Transactions could originate either from a consumer or within a coalition. And based on where the transaction originates, how the transaction originates, the consensus algorithm which is run has to be different, right? It could be a bunch of private nodes which are doing something very confidential, or it could be a public. So we have a very unique federated Byzantine consensus algorithm developed by three of our spectacular blockchain engineers. First one is Dr. Bhavya Kalikura. He's a scholar in Byzantine consensus in the presence of Byzantine, right? He's got like 7 or 8, he's a PhD himself. All his PhD research has been in doing consensus in the presence of Byzantine, right? And second one is Dr. Prem Upaluri. He's a professor at Radford University, and his primary focus is enterprise security and cybersecurity, right? Very critical, again, for this particular application of ours, which is infrastructure project of ours, which is Zagg. And then Sergey Petkovich, he's been in blockchain for the last 6-7 years. He really understands the nitty-gritty of it, and he's been a spectacular person to help us build this new consensus algorithm. Again, I said one of the key differentiators, which is something which you and I can relate to, is finally when your financial assets are liquid, financial assets are discoverable in terms of value, and provide an easy exchange where you have a gift card of $100, you want to sell it to me, I'll buy it at $85, and world is a happy place. What is our business model? Our business model is very simple. For every transaction happening on Zagg network, there's a transaction fee goes both from the buyer and the seller to us. Secondly, there's an exchange fee whenever there's an asset being transferred on the network between users or between enterprises. We get a transaction fee, or the network gets a transaction fee. And most importantly, where does the big money come in, big fiat resources come in, that is when merchants get onboarded and they bring their loyalty programs in, they actually buy significant stake on the network, right? They buy the tokens and stake it, because a United Airlines one comes in will probably have, I don't know, 10,000 coins versus a small merchant, mom and pop merchant may probably do 10 tokens, right? So an ability for them to bring in their existing financial resources provides enormous amount of liquidity within the market. And these transactions provide an ability for the community to make some revenues. Whatever revenues are made, obviously, are split across the community for incentives for new nodes, for transaction verification, for community building, and for operational expenses. Well, obviously, the picture is fantastic. That's what I signed up for, right? But do we have something to really back it up in terms of ability to execute, right? Our key strengths, as I see, and I believe, and I'm going to execute to, is our team, partners, and advisors. Our team, I've just talked about myself, but more importantly, I wanted to reiterate Raj. He's our founder. He's had 20 years experience. Today, he's owner of Zaggle, which is a parent company of Zagg, which has 100 million revenues, around 2.5 million users in India and Southeast Asia countries, specifically focused on loyalty and gift card market. Before that, he was an investor in a loyalty rewards company, which he sold. Before that, he was founder and CEO of SSL Limited, which was a fintech payments company, which he sold. So he understands business and value creation. I understand business value creation, specifically in the context of startups. What he also brings in is an enormous set of abilities on the domain side, right? Michael Turpin has been fantastic in terms of being an advisor for us, and we look forward to having a fantastic and fruitful relationship with Michael. We've been very fortunate to actually attract some of the best guys. Vinny Lingam is now our advisor as well. And why is Vinny very important for us? Because he actually raised money from Google Ventures in a company called Gift not too long ago, I think in 4 years back, and he sold it to First Data for around $50 million, right? So he also has very, very relevant information, expertise to make our business happen. Avinash actually heads and runs Zaggle in India and Southeast Asian countries. And obviously, we have a few others like John Juno and Luke Lassen, who've been helping us to really through in this process. In terms of technology, Paul has been, he was with Intel for around 20 years. And then last 7-8 years, he ran a loyalty space. Sergey Petkovich, I just said, he's the guy who's helping us with our blockchain protocol. Bhavya, Dr. Bhavya, and Dr. Prem are our protocol consensus gurus. And we've got a fantastic set of young Turks who are helping us build our protocol. And some of these guys also have experience in payments, like Sahith worked for Paytm, India's largest payment wallet company, right? So we really understand the domain and we understand tech. I'm an engineer, graduated from IIT Madras. I have a master's in computer engineering and an MBA from UCLA, right? So I kind of, and I've been in startups, we kind of understand what kind of product needs to be built to create extraordinary value for in startup ecosystem. And okay, so we've got team, we've got a fantastic set of advisors, and then partners are very, very critical for us, especially given that this is not just about building a protocol and then waiting for people to show up, it is about also helping making the market happen, specifically with respect to getting merchants on board, getting these loyalty owners on board, getting these program managers on board, and Zaggle being our parent company, gives us an immediate jump start to our Zagg economy. They have 100 million revenues, serving more than 2.5 million users, 6,500 merchants. So that's a fantastic asset we can bring in on day one the protocol begins, kickstart the economy, and over a period of time bring other partners in. Who are the other partners who are in our pipeline? We have a bunch of merchants we've signed up as part of a Zaggle parent company who are going to be inherit as part of the Zagg network. Obviously, we have a bunch of technology partners like IBM and Oracle. We are seeing a lot of interest now from crypto companies who want to offer loyalty points for their users. And those also would be a set of partners who can potentially be onboarded, right? So for us, anybody who offers loyalty gift card is our partner. We want to have them onboarded on our network. And they, in turn, offer whatever services they want to offer to the end consumer. Where are we now? We are doing our token sale. We are total 1 billion tokens. Of that, we're offering 500 million at 10 cents for sale. Our soft target is 7. Of that, we have already 4.5 million committed from a couple of marquee venture capitalists, Venture East and GKFF. Our target is to raise 40 through our private sale and maybe a little bit of public to ensure that there is some liquidity for our investors and get a larger private sale going, because we see this as potentially ability to fundamentally change a very large industry. To just give you a size, the GBRL industry, this gift card benefits, rewards and loyalty, expected to have around $3 trillion of assets by 2030. Right? Today, it may be around $1.5 billion, fastest growing at 23-24% a year. So there's a lot of money which is sitting. It's a huge market. And our ability to move that onto crypto is really going to be a force multiplier for just the crypto community and just for the industry and for consumers like you and me. I'll stop my presentation here. Take any questions.
Well, thank you so much. Protocols is a great thing right now on the market. You know, it's a protocol frenzy, blockchain, new infrastructure frenzy. Crypto funds love protocols. You know, you go with the protocol, you get the private sale is closed. This protocol is native to rewards, gift cards, and so. So I have two questions. So the first question is, can you use the protocol for something else? For not only for rewards and gift cards, and then the second question is partnerships, because they drive the adoption of the coin and the product post ICO. So you listed a long list of amazing companies. Have they signed already?
Okay, so first question is,
thank you.
Yes, as entrepreneurs, we definitely want to apply. The biggest part is the IP generation. So obviously, we would be applying the same protocol to other industries which have similar dynamics. And the dynamics very consistent are the dynamics of B2B2C, right? There are a lot of companies who offer services to end consumers. And there needs to be a clearing platform for them. So we have had very early conversations like insurance kind of industries, right? As we said, we are still scratching the surface. And I believe because the way we are designing the system, there is an ability to actually be horizontal for all of these industries where there is a need for private and public. That's first question, right? Second question, all these relationships which I just put up are already existing relationships with our parent company, Zagg. So, and in our case, there will be two kinds of partnerships. First kind of partnerships who will generate these rewards or gift cards or loyalties, and second would be the consumers of these, right? Many of these are consumers, and some of these are going to be also generating those financial assets. So it's a mix of both. Yes, and short answer is yes. Yes.
How do you keep the universal ID from being reverse engineered to figure out customers' spending patterns and stuff like that?
Okay, so I have some answer. I don't know if I have comprehensive answer. So we are trying to ensure that none of the end user information is on the chain, because we want to be GDPR compliant. So there's a lot of emphasis when you're developing the protocol is to, can you have the entire KYC information on the user's mobile phone, where you take the entire information, you hash it once, do a KYC saying, okay, for this user, KYC is done, put the hash on the chain, and that hash is actually used as authentication across. So whenever the merchant, when the user wants to sign up for another program, he uses the hash instead of using his KYC, right? So that way, we definitely don't want to our goal is to not have the personal information on the chain. Only ideally have the hash, just so that it's right, that's the right thing to do. And that one hopefully is expected to be the universal currency, not currency, right? Universal ID for that user across the GBRL ecosystem.
Right, but that lets me know that you've shopped at these 10 stores without knowing, like, and if you shop in my store, now I can reverse engineer that. And that's really like
a lot. Yeah, so in fact, that's the reason why, excellent, right? That's the reason why we are actually coming with private and public. Because all the transactions which are supposed to be private and either the merchant or the because these are all assets which are part of the gift card community or a mm-hmm. brand is giving or loyalty points, right? They probably don't want those transactions to be available public. So this will be only reconciled in a private subnetwork or the coalition. Mm-hmm. And a hash of that, a cryptographic signature of that, is put on the public.
Okay.
So that on the public, nobody really knows where you've shopped.
So, great. So you've talked about the business side, but what does this look like for the end consumer?
End consumer, in my ideal world, would be you'll probably have one app or 100 apps. One app definitely would be where you can either you're enrolled into 10 programs or you already are enrolled into 10 programs. You can see those 10 programs. And you have $50 gift card of Starbucks, and you're saying, I'm never going to go to Starbucks, you can actually sell it to the gentleman across the street, right? Probably you'll take a discount because that's where the market happens. You have loyalty points. You now need to know the value for it. It'll tell you the value, and then you can trade it either for a good.
But this sounds very theoretical. Do you have like an end user loyalty app?
So we have a sample reference app, but
yeah.
Our entire premise is to come up with is the infrastructure project, right? And then we will have one app where we would be a Zagg app where it would some of these features will be there. But our entire goal is to also have other apps from, say, Starbucks would have its own app. It would onboard its own program onto this. So we are not just one app. We actually, every program owner will have his own app where he will probably say, Star Alliance will say, okay, I'm going to allow a coalition within the Star Alliance to happen through mm-hmm. their app, right? But it will be running on the Zagg infrastructure as a clearinghouse.
Okay. How do you see the cost per transaction? Because you mentioned it being on the user side and on the merchant side.
Yeah. So it was a very critical part of our design mm-hmm. to ensure that the transaction costs are very low. And that's why there's no mining here. All the nodes participating in the network are only validating the transaction. And in our case, the beautiful thing is it's a hybrid of nodes which are more trustworthy than public nodes. So hence
do you see it being like a cent, like one US cent per transaction? Do you see it being?
Oh, yeah. Actually, it has to be substantially lower than that, right? So typically, Visa fees today is like 1-1.5%, right? We'll be 1/100th of that. Because we are only validating the transactions, we are not doing mining, so there's no power cost. And because there's no intermediary, every brand who owns his assets is directly trading with the other brand who is the consumer of those assets. So there's really no intermediary to be charging a toll tax,
okay.
Like a Visa.
One final question. How does the ERC-20 token interact with the private blockchain?
Okay, so actually this is only a
network.
ERC-20 token is right now purely a fundraising instrument. Once our blockchain is up and running, which we expect the beta should be up and running by next fall or so, all the token holders of
next fall being like
2020. 2019.
So
2019 is when our beta version of our full infrastructure will be up and running. At which point, all the token holders will be given a token on our, will be given Zagg coins of our protocol, mm-hmm. and these will become worthless.
One question over here.
Okay. But yeah.
Just ask one question. Sorry, mate. Really simple. You've obviously got lots of great partners written up on your PowerPoint. You mentioned IBM and Oracle there. Have either of those two companies actually reviewed your protocol and given you an opinion of whether it actually will work? And have you got any documentation to prove that IBM is working with you to support this protocol?
So definitely, we have documentation to support that IBM is working with us. Having said that, okay, just a caveat, I'll just come back to you.
So who is it? IBM India, IBM US? Who have you actually specifically got
IBM people working on this protocol with you?
So when we started the conversation, right, we were going and going to use the IBM Hyperledger as one of the private blockchain technologies.
Do you have IBM people working on this protocol at the moment?
I think in India. No, they are not implementing the protocol. We are actually working
are
with
them IBM on people working on this protocol at the moment?
No, they are not working on this one. Yes. Okay. Because we are working with them. They are
That's fine. I'm not trying to catch you out.
Yeah, sorry.
I think my question is related to this. When you put IBM, does that mean you pay them as anybody can get and say IBM is our partners because you pay them, right? For the service.
Yeah.
And you can just list them on the platform. Is that correct?
Okay. So we are looking at this in a multi-phase approach, right? The first phase will probably use IBM Hyperledger to do some of the private stuff, while public is our own consensus.
But it's a bit misleading though when you say partnership, no?
If I can just clear. Sure. Okay. The expectation is that by next summer, when we have the full beta protocol done, we will actually not be using any of the existing technologies out there, including Hyperledger, at which point our consensus algorithm, our infrastructure will be completely independent. We don't have to pay a single pie royalty to anybody.
Sure. Do you have, now as I understand from your presentation, you're writing at the back of the success made by Mr. Raj Pani,
with his
Zagg and the success story. Yeah. You're basing your credibility at the back of that now.
Yeah.
100% at the moment.
Yes.
So what my question
and
is
and the company.
But my question is, have you developed anything technology-wise on the site from outside of Zagg at the moment?
So Zagg to be able to support 100 million revenues has lot of existing technology components already built, right? But those are for legacy businesses where they are integrated with the existing POS systems. What we are doing now as part of the last 3-4 months as part of Zagg protocol is to move a lot of that infrastructure to blockchain, at which point we realize that in fact Hyperledger doesn't work. But we are doing Hyperledger just to get the MVP done. We realize that we actually have to come up with a new protocol which is fundamentally new. That's when we have a team who is working on the new protocol itself.
Has not finished anything on protocol.
Protocol is a pain. It's a big effort. And we've got the basic consensus algorithm done. Mm-hmm. We are simulating it. And it does take some time to.
Yeah, sure. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Michael.